When Ridley Scott announced that he would be returning to the director's chair for a follow-up to his sci-fi horror masterpiece, a lot of people were justifiably pumped. Finally, we are going to get answers, not only to 30-year-old questions about the original Alien, but we are going to see some deep philosophical questions addressed as well. What we got instead were characters that made painfully stupid decisions and a plot that provided exactly zero answers. In the end, all Prometheus was really good-looking sequel bait. We should have been terrified for the characters because we liked them, not because we were waiting to see how they'd die. We should have been invested in the story because it was well told, not because it promised a new type of alien. Prometheus should have been a horror movie with a brain, and a sci-fi movie with a heart. So, with that in mind, let's try to fix Prometheus. The movie begins the same. We see the engineer drink the goo, disintegrate, and seed the Earth with his DNA. We then cut to the Prometheus in the present. All of the characters in the original Alien were blue-collar, working-class people, so we were scared for them when they were forced into a situation beyond their knowledge and control. The scientist in the release movie had pure motives with no agenda, which gave them no reason to make reckless and unscientific decisions throughout the film. So, instead of our main character being a scientist, Elizabeth Shaw is the captain of the Prometheus, Yannick is her first mate, and Fifield is the ship's security officer. In her quarters, we see Captain Shaw crying over the picture of a sonogram when Yannick comes in. He asks her whether or not they're going to accept Meredith Vicker's proposal. Yannick points out that Shaw's been through a lot recently, and that maybe the work will take her mind off of things. Their familiarity shows us that they're very close and know each other very well. So, Captain Shaw tells him to let Vickers know that they accept. Having the ship's crew as the protagonists explains why they would go to the other side of the universe without all the details beforehand. We then get the mission briefing led by Dr. Holloway. His theory is that the engineers seeded Earth with life, not specifically humans. This fits with the whole pesky evolution thing, instead of just ignoring it. After the briefing, Shaw asks Holloway what he expects to find. He says they might just find out who created humanity. Fingering the crucifix around her neck, Shaw says that she already knows who created her. It's clear the whole idea of meeting their maker offends her. They land the Prometheus and organize the first outing. Then they go inside the dome. They go on to discover the urn room. Not the one with the big head, the one with all the stacked urns. We see that the urns are coded within subgroups, which tells us that they're samples from different experiments. This explains why the black goo does different things whenever it's used, because there are different versions of it. They bag one of the urns and prepare to take it back to the ship for study. Vickers orders Milburn to continue mapping, and Shaw sends Yannick to keep an eye on him. Meanwhile, the rest of the party return to the ship to study the black goo. They discover that it has all of the basic chromosomes that all life on Earth is based on, and they theorize that the black goo was used to begin life on Earth, reasoning that it's some kind of mutagen that creates specific changes in any organism it comes in contact with. And Holloway's not disappointed with the greatest discovery in human history. No, in this version, he's drinking to celebrate it. David spikes his drink, which we see him do before he's standing right next to him. Shaw is the one who's drowning her sorrows. Holloway goes over and asks why she's not happy. She shows him her crucifix and says that she used to be sure of where she came from and why, but now, not so much. He Shaw downs another drink and says that her faith has been stretched thin lately. She goes on to tell him that she spent a lot of money on artificial insemination and that recently she lost the baby. To get her mind off of things, Holloway flirts with her some more and they end up having sex. But no time to cuddle because Yannick contacts the ship with a discovery. Yannick and Milburn find the big headroom, and instead of no crew being on duty whatsoever, everyone on the bridge watches them enter the room, and they see the frescoes on the walls. They depict the engineers discovering the black goo, meaning that they didn't make it, they were just experimenting with it. Just like in the original, the change in the atmosphere has caused the urns to leak the black goo all over the floor. And just like in the original, it's mutated the worms. Milburn and Yannick try to leave, but the video cuts out and everyone on the ship is forced to listen as they're horribly attacked. Captain Shaw leads a rescue party, with Holloway staying behind because he's not feeling well. As they're searching for Yannick and Milburn, David makes the epic discovery of the sleeping engineer. Meanwhile, back on the ship, Holloway begins to transform into what looks like a xenomorph. Shaw and the rescue party find the snakes feeding on Yannick and Milburn's bodies. Furious, she tells Vickers that they are leaving. Vickers says that they aren't going anywhere until they get what they came for. The attack scene plays out the same, and Holloway mutating into a xenomorph is a little easier to swallow than the movie not bothering to explain why someone was randomly zombified. Captain Shaw calls for a complete quarantine protocol, and that's when David tells her that she's pregnant. The whole alien cesarean scene plays out the same. After that, Shaw discovers Waylon, the same way she did in the released version. Shaw is horrified that several people have died all for him to have more life. Waylon gives her the same speech about finding out why humanity was created, finding out the meaning of all of their lives. At this point, Shaw has been stripped of almost everything, and she really has nothing left but to find out why the engineers created them. They reach the engineer and revive him, just like in the release version. But when they speak to the engineer, he speaks back. He studies them intently, and then, with contempt, he says something that David translates to, "You are not what was intended." Humanity is revealed to be a failed experiment, a mistake. As far as why the engineers did what they did, this is a better answer than no answer. The engineer proceeds to rip David's head off and starts killing everyone. Captain Shaw runs away and reaches the surface. She tells Fifield what's happening and what's at stake. Then he decides to use the Prometheus as a bullet to crash the engineer's ship. Shaw makes her way to the lifeboat, and she's attacked by the engineer. She lets the squid hugger out of the medbay to attack the engineer. With the engineer dead, Shaw's left alone with David, and she says that she's going to die. She grabs the release on her helmet, preparing to kill herself. But David says the alien ship can return to its point of origin. Now Shaw has the opportunity to experience what happens when we die, meeting her maker, so to speak. But she decides to go on to the engineer's homeworld to seek the answers that have been plaguing her throughout the movie. This ending isn't so much of a cliffhanger as the original was. It's more rhetorical, begging the question, which would you choose, to trust your faith and go into the unknown, or ride into hell to know the answer to why? Hopefully this version answers most of the specific questions raised by the story, and provides a good setup to ponder the more profound ones. So, that's how I would fix Prometheus. Are there any movies that you think are in need of repair? If so, email me at the link down below or post a comment. And remember to click like and subscribe if you want to see more movies get fixed. Until next time, I'm Mr. Fix-It for Fix the Flick.